And welcome to a special call meeting of the city commissioners. We have two items on the agenda, and this is a business meeting, and we do have to formally open it and everything. So we'll go ahead and start with that. Call roll, please. Stevens? Sims?
Here.
Harrod?
Here.
Peterson?
Here.
Collier?
Here.
Winteringer? Smith?
Here.
Thank you. The first item is a presentation and discussion of water yield study. And we'll start with that, and Brian will probably introduce the ones who put all the work into it and got us here.
Some of the longer time commissioners and some of the folks that actually filed the city a little bit will remember that in 2007, the city commissioners asked the staff to go to the Corps of Engineers to talk about how much water we have in our community. In 2009, we talked about it and went to the Corps, and the Corps took 8 months to tell us that they couldn't do it for us. They didn't have the time. They were looking for some grant funding sources, things of that nature. You'll remember, too, that back during that period of time, Oklahoma City was involved in the Sark's Lake project. And that project is to bring water from Sark's Lake in southeast Oklahoma to Oklahoma City. As part of that, City of Shawnee got on board just to study the possibility of us potentially needing that water or using that water. Along comes the new city manager and says, okay, Jim Beard's going to love this because he picks on me for it all the time, and says, well, Jim, how do we know we need to be on the Sark's Lake stuff if we don't know what kind of capacity for water that we currently have in the future? Let's look at the facts. What is, do we have enough water for our growth in industry and people for 10 years, or do we have enough growth for 50 years? What is it? Hence, Amber and Kirk here from Camp Dresser and McGee, they will be here to talk tonight about the study that it's taken us about 18 months to get, 12 to 18 months to get done. There were several pieces of that scope of work, but the primary one was is, do we have water, and how much water do we have based on our growth in industry and people over the next 50 years? And then the second part, the most important part for us is, as your city staff that manage the water resources that we have, is what's our drought management plan? We've got two reservoirs now. They'll show you that we have enough water into the 50-year planning period. But the last part is when you start seeing those lakes in Twin Lakes and Linda, you guys that live on the lake, you start seeing that recede. How much water is left in the lake? What does that mean? What does that number on the edge of the tower mean? After they get through with their presentation today, I think you guys will be surprised. So with any further ado, Kurt and Amber, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you, everyone, for having us here tonight. I'm Amber Lupin, and this is my colleague, Kirk Westfall. As Brian said, we want to discuss the results of this reservoir yield study. Brian gave a great introduction about why the project was needed. What I'd like to do is define two terms that you'll hear tonight, just so we're all talking in the same language. The first is firm yield, and this is the amount of water that you can take out of the reservoir all of the time. You can exceed the firm yield in wet periods, but the number that we're presenting tonight is firm yield, so it's 100% reliable. The second term is annual average day demand, and in water we use the demand terminology a lot. And what this term means is if you take the amount of water that you use in 1 year period, divided into equal increments, that is your annual average day demand. And that is the common term used when discussing raw water supply. You may be used to hearing about peak water or peak day demand, and that's a term that's often used in water treatment or in other infrastructure sizing, but the number that we're talking about tonight and the number that we size raw water supply around is the annual average day demand. These are the results. We wanted to give you a preview, and we're going to walk through how we got these, but if you only remember two things tonight, these are the two things I'd like you to remember. One, even in the lowest yielding scenario, you have enough water to meet your 2060 projected demand. And two, at the end of this study, you have a drought management plan that tells you what actions to take when situations present themselves that negatively impact your raw water supply. Let me tell you about this chart. In blue is the water bill. And so this is the amount of water physically available when you operate West Watkins and Twin Lakes as a system. And we're going to get into this in a little more detail, but I want to give this to you as kind of a background for what you'll be seeing later on. In green is the amount available to Shawnee. And the difference between those numbers is that the green number takes into account permit restrictions as well as water that's allocated to other users, specifically Tecumseh from the West Watkins Reservoir. The first step, and we'll come back to this at the end after you've seen how we've gotten there. With that, I'll turn it over to Kurt to tell a little more about the yield model.
Thanks, everybody, for having us here tonight. Again, I appreciate this. This has been a very interesting study, and I think we went into it asking the questions that a lot of you were asking, and that is, you know, how much water really is available in these reservoirs, and when we start to see them go down, how much should we start to worry, and what concerns should we have? And then beyond that is, how do we actually manage this? These are not just individual sources, but they are sources that can be operated as a system. So we're going to talk a little bit about what that means and what opportunities that gives to you as a community to have your water. We'll be showing you some results. Some of you have seen the report that we've issued. We're going to be pulling some key findings from that report out tonight. We're going to be showing you some results that came from a computer simulation model. One of the most important things about water planning is that it's based on historical evidence. It's based on things that have happened in the past. It's based on 50 years of historical patterns of river flows and precipitation and so forth. And we use that as best we can to predict what's going to happen in the future. And we do that with simulation models. A lot of it we're not going to get into detail on tonight, but we're going to be presenting results from. Basically, it looks at your reservoirs here in Shawnee and simulates how much water is flowing into those reservoirs on a monthly basis. How much water is lost to evaporation, how much water is lost to seepage through the dam, how much water flows directly onto the reservoirs, how much water is taken out, withdrawals from the treatment plant, and how much water actually can be used between the reservoirs. Between lakes, there's water that passes back and forth between them under certain conditions. And on top of this, there's West Watkins. Can West Watkins and the Twin Lakes be used together as a system to best manage water supply with some equity in terms of how the lakes respond? So the numbers that you're going to see are coming from a computer simulation model that looks at about 50 years worth of historical evidence of the hydrology of this region. That's how rain turns into rivers and runs into reservoirs for storage. We've taken that 50 years and we've projected it forward in time, and we're looking at how much water will become available in these reservoirs. There are a lot of different ways to do that. And the obvious and most easy way to predict how much water you have is to look exactly at how much water you have had in the past. And when you're lucky, you have gauges on rivers that measure stream flow every day. And you have records, long-term records, of how much water has been flowing into your system or out of your system. The reservoirs in Shawnee don't have gauges. So there are other techniques that we can use to estimate how much water flows into the system. In 2008-2009, as Brian's mentioning, we worked with the Oklahoma Water Resources Board on developing a procedure, a statewide procedure for developing fermial analysis for reservoirs and reservoir systems like this. And the first step in that analysis is to estimate the river flows, the runoff, how much water actually flows in. And there are four or five ways to do that when you don't have actual measured data of stream flow. And we applied all of those measures, all of those techniques, this study and found the one that actually best replicated the data that we do have for Shawnee. You notice the red line here shows about the last 5 or 6 years of storage in the system. This, I believe, is Twin Lakes. This is an elevation of Twin Lakes. The green line represents what the computer simulation model reproduced for these last 5 or 6 years. And we generated one of these lines for each of the different techniques that we developed used or applied to estimate the stream flow. And this one was the one that reproduced your patterns the best. There was no doubt about it. It reproduced the low flow conditions very well. It reproduced the high flow conditions very well. It reproduced the everyday conditions very well. And it was the simplest one to use. It was the method that takes an adjoining basin. We used a little river in this south of where we are. There are two stream flow gauges the USGS operates on that river that have long-term historical records. And we used that information and transposed it into these basins, confirming that there was enough similarity in the topography and so forth soils that was justifiable. And then tested by seeing if that prediction of runoff could actually reproduce the way your reservoirs have responded. That's the first step in a credible yield analysis, is estimating how much flow is coming into the reservoirs. And we feel we have a very good handle on that. The next step is to test yield. How much can you withdraw from the reservoir? Now that you know how much is coming in, how much can we take out on a consistent basis without running out of water? Or, as Amber was saying, without running up against a permit constraint? Or without dropping the levels too low so that now they're uncomfortable? There's a lot of different constraints to be considered here. The first thing I'll say is that when you look at Twin Lakes on their own, they can produce about 5.5 million gallons a day of water. Just look at Twin Lakes on their own. If you look at just West Watkins on its own, it can produce anywhere between 3 and 4.5, I think, MGD, depending on the constraints that are applied. So either one of those sources on its own has water sufficient or close to being sufficient, actually, to extend all the way to the 2060 demand levels that you're projecting, which is 4.7 MGD, which is on Landers Pad. But the opportunity that you have with two reservoirs instead of just one, or two that operate individually, is to manage them in ways that can either augment that combined yield. Usually we find, and we found it here, that the combined yield of two reservoirs operating together is greater than the sum of the two individual reservoirs. And we found that here. Instead of somewhere between 8.5 and 9.5 million gallons of the combined yield when we add the two up, we can get up to about 10 million gallons a day if we operate them intelligently and purposefully together. It doesn't mean it's the best way to operate. I'm going to show you four different traces of how the reservoirs would have looked over time, operated a little bit differently each time. This is basically a map in time, 1952 to 2008. It uses historical data to show how the reservoirs would have responded if we were to draw water out at a constant rate equal to their firm yield. Okay? We orient you here because we're going to see a few graphs like this. The tops of the reservoirs are up here, both very close in elevation. The bottoms are down here. Again, very close to the bottom elevation. And you can see that firm yield is defined by the reservoir running out, going all the way down to the bottom. And by bottom, I don't mean the mud at the bottom. I mean where the pipe actually comes in to take the water out of the reservoir into the treatment plant. Okay, that's actually available water. At West Watkins, we have another elevation that's critical, and that's the recreational level. That's the level which the reservoir is not supposed to drop below so that we can maintain enough water in it for recreational activity. Okay? We looked at this a couple different ways. We have a computer model, we have the luxury of doing some experiments. So we asked, how much yield is available without that constraint? How much yield is available with that constraint? Let's understand what that constraint actually means to us. Okay? And then as we started to gather that information, you can see how we formulated it into some plans. This first scenario is what we're calling prioritizing West Watkins. It's purely experimental. This isn't necessarily a recommendation. What we wanted to see is, we know that West Watkins can produce anywhere between 3 and 4.5 million gallons a day. But what if we took more from West Watkins during wet periods, okay, and let the Twin Lakes rest a little bit, and then tap them a little bit when it got dry, keep the reserve there. We prioritize West Watkins, overdraft it in effect, take more than its sustainable yield, and then go back to Twin Lakes later. When we do that, we can get a firm yield up to 10.1. from the system, or when you apply the constraints of both the permit and the amount that's reserved for Tecumseh, that goes down to 9.2. Okay. When we flip that around and say, let's look at Twin Lakes first. Let's overdraw from Twin Lakes. Let's take more water than we can from Twin Lakes, and then only go to West Watkins really when we need to, when we hit certain levels in Twin Lakes. Again, this is not a recommendation. This is purely experimental, to see if there are different ways of operating the system and what it's sensitive to. And you can see in this scenario, the blue here are the Twin Lakes, and they draw down much more quickly than West Watkins, because that's where we're drawing water from first in this experiment. GD or 9.1 when you take into account the actual permit in this case. Okay? So it really didn't, what we learned there is it didn't matter if we prioritize one reservoir over the other. That's an important finding. When you have two that can be operated together, it's important to know if one is more sensitive than the other. In this case, it really isn't. That's an important finding. We're not recommending that you operate that way. You notice that in both of those cases, West Watkins dropped down below the recreational. Now we ask the question, what happens if we don't let that happen? The green line here again is West Watkins. Again, this is the same 50-year period, almost 60 years. And we're asking, what if we were to draw this amount of water out of West Watkins and Twin Lakes for that period, but not allow West Watkins to drop down below its recreational level? Okay. In this case, you can see that it does that. It stays up above that level. It approaches it a couple of times, but it doesn't drop below it. And the firm yield here, the amount that was being drawn all the way through this period, was 9.4 million gallons a day. That's what's available. And of that, 7.4 would have been available to Shawnee. Again, that doesn't necessarily mean this is the best way to operate, but we're starting to get a little closer. We learned that it doesn't matter which reservoir is tapped first. We learned that it does matter that keeping West Watkins up above its recreational pool has an impact. That yield went down from about 9.2, 9.3 down to 7.4. That's the impact of the recreational pool. That's a sensitive factor in your system. It's important to know that. The last thing we looked at, and this sort of evolved into the recommended guidance for the system, is balancing the lakes. Instead of drawing from one first and then going to the other, draw from them both at the same time so that over time they fluctuate together. If one of them is down 1 foot, so is the other one. If one of them is down 3 feet, so is the other one. Keep them in balance. Let them recover together, let them draw down together. And how does that affect the yield? We're now constraining ourselves quite a bit more because we are taking water from a source that, you know, maybe we'd rather let it sit there for a while. But you can see they follow the same pattern over time. Drawn down together, and they recover together over the entire cycle of the historical record. Now, Twin Lakes, of course, will draw down further because we stop taking from West Watkins when it gets to its recreational pool. And that's an important constraint. It's important to include that in recommendations. That's an important factor to the city, which I believe it is. So we enforce that here. And here the firm yield, and again the difference, the key difference here, firm yield is 8.2 mg, and we keep the lakes balanced. That's the water that's physically available. You could actually take that water. What's limited by permits and by Tecumseh's right to 0.7, the West Watkins, is 4.7. That's a fairly significant jump. Okay? We were talking about 7s, 8s, and 9s. For the yield, now we're down to about 4.7. But this is, as Amber said, under the most constrained operating condition that you would ever really see. And it's a discretionary practice that you, as a city and your staff, can decide to do. Now, when you have a drought, we're going to get into some drought measures very, very quickly here. When you have a drought, you've seen already that there are other ways of operating the system that produce more yield. So, in effect, by operating the lakes this way, keeping them in balance, you're providing for more or less some equity in the recreational and environmental benefits that are sustained in those two lakes through a drought. You do cut into your yield, but you're keeping water in reserve. You do have water in West Watkins below the recreational pool that I would consider emergency water use. If you absolutely needed it, you can get it. You have to ask for it, you can get it. You can also start to prioritize these feel that you're heading into a drought. We have triggers for this, but we'll show you what those are in a few minutes. When you see that you're heading into a severe drought, you can switch from this balancing to prioritizing, because you know that those give you more yield. Okay? So the fact is that, as Amber showed you earlier, the projected demand on an average annual basis is 4.7 MGD 50 years out. That's in 2060. And what we've kind of worked back to here is that under this sort of idealized, even though it's worst case, it's sort of ideal environmentally and practically, because the lakes are imbalanced, you still have that much available. Even when you take into account the permit constraints, other users, and everything else. So that's sort of a summary of the water that is actually physically available.
Why do we have data when the lake didn't even exist, when it didn't exist.
Good question. Good question. This is a what if. This is an experiment. The data is actually coming from a watershed to the south. It's coming from the Little River. So the data that we use to synthesize the stream flow to come into the reservoirs, just for experimental purposes, came from a river that was gauged and measured back from 1952 all the way to the present. What we're doing here is asking what if. Since we can't look forward to what the climate and the river flow will be for the next 50 years, we look back and see what it was for the last 50 years and ask how would the reservoirs have responded under those hydrologic conditions. And so the assumption is an important question. The assumption is that the next 50 years will be based on the same hydrologic patterns as the past 50 years. And now that is an assumption, right? It doesn't take into account potential climate change, changes in land use that can affect runoff, things like that. It looks at the past 50 years, and in this case, we're benefiting from some very severe droughts that occurred in that period of record. The 50s, the 60s, and the 80s all had very severe droughts that affected the system in different ways. And because of that, we have a high level of confidence that, you know, unless you have a drought that's much worse than anything you've seen, you've got a very good historical basis to base your projections on that forward.
Why you separated out Twin Lake 1 and Twin Lake 2, because the drawdown on them is different?
It is after a point. There's a canal that connects the two lakes, and once you get down below that canal, they're no longer connected. They're two lakes instead of one. And so for a while up near the top, you see they all back together because they're one water body. But the canal that connects them has a fairly high invert elevation. And once you get below that, they become separate.
If that were to dredge down, would that make a difference in that?
Not really. Good question. Because you see, they still track pretty close. And we did some experiments with that and found that there's not a lot of variation in the way they track. They pretty much draw down when they flow together.
I had one quick question. Like last year, July, August, we had those two dry drought months.
Mm-hmm.
How did that affect the scenario there?
Good question. We actually, if you can wait a few minutes, we're going to touch on that in a few minutes when we start talking about the drought management. But one of the driving questions for the study is, you know, we see these water levels going down, and what does that mean? How much water is left? Are we at risk? And should we do anything? And basically, at the demand levels you're at now, the quick answer to that is no. You were not at risk during those months. We looked at that. Amber's got some specific numbers that she'll share with you in a few minutes. But what we've done is taken what we've learned here now and identify critical elevations all the way up and down. Not just this recreational pool, but triggers even before that and after that indicate, okay, this is when you should start conserving water modestly. This is when you should start conserving water aggressively. This is when you should really start enforcing the conservation market. But that's all based on some risk analysis that we did by saying, all right, let's say we are in last summer. Let's say we're right about here. What does that mean? Does it mean we're at risk of having this happen? Or are we only going to draw down? So we worked with the staff extensively on this and looked at the risks associated with conditions like that and developed a drought management plan from that. And Amber will be going into that. One important caveat that we wanted to mention is that we have been talking in terms of pure water availability. And this water is not pumped to the treatment plants. Flows by gravity. Okay? And when the water level drops substantially in the reservoirs, you don't have as much pressure to push the water through the pipes in the treatment plants. And what we found is when you operate the two reservoirs individually, that's not so much of a problem because the flows don't get so high. But when you operate them together, and you may be taking all of the yield of 9 or 10 or 8 from one reservoir, you can experience some restrictions. Now, what we have found is that during a very severe drought, there's about a 3 or 4 or 5% chance that that would happen. But I think it's an important thing to keep in mind as you do your master planning for your facilities. We did not look at that as part of our scope of work here. We really looked at just the water availability. But what we discovered along the way is that there's a slight risk if you're operating the reservoirs together and taking all of your yield from one reservoir, that you may run into some situations where there's not enough pressure to push that water through to the treatment plant. Now, under the scenario where the water is balanced and you're only drawing 4.7 MGD to begin with, shouldn't be an issue. Okay? And that's as far as your demand projections go at this point. So I raise it as a caution, as something I think you need to plan for eventually. Probably not an imminent concern, but something you need to keep in your mind.
You didn't determine the elevation of what that might happen.
We did. In fact, we didn't. It was handed to us from the staff. They have some fairly detailed hydraulic records of the system and what water can flow through the pipes at different elevations. And we incorporated that into this.
That drought plan, one of the areas I think we had some difficulty, if my memory serves me correctly, that we go down to like 1059, we did have some flow problems, and I hope in the drought plan we go way below that before we start implementing some of the control.
Those are excellent segues into the drought plan. I think we're going to talk just a little bit about the watershed itself first and some things that we found, and then Amber is going to talk about the drought management.
Yeah, so one of the first steps that we did, and this resulted actually from a question that the commission had for staff, was there anything in the watersheds, Twin Lakes and West Watkins, that limited the amount of flow that was getting to the reservoirs? Is there a way that we can make the watersheds more And so one of the first things we did was we did a windshield survey and went out and looked at extensively the Twin Lakes and the West Watkins watershed. And what we found was is that there was nothing unusual in the watershed. I've included three photos. The first one is in Twin Lakes and the second two are in West Watkins. And these are pretty typical of what we saw. And while these three photos indicate possible low flow impediments, the impediments are not significant and are not such that we would recommend action. In fact, they may enhance the filtration and prevent your reservoirs from being nutrient loaded. The first one, it's actually a fairly clear drainage channel, and in the middle, it's difficult to see, but there's a dead tree that it appeared to be placed there. It didn't appear to be fallen. So that's obviously, it may prevent some low flow, but as I said, it's not significant. In this photo, right here in the middle, that's a drainage culvert. It's partially blocked. Not, once again, not unusual, not significant. And the last photo is a stream bed that is winding, has some debris, but not enough debris that would block the flow. So as I said, nothing that we found was unusual. One of the other things that we did was we went out and looked at seepage from the reservoir. That has been a concern. We made three visual observations. During two of those observations, we saw minimal seepage. During the third observation, we actually didn't see any. For the sake of modeling, we chose a very conservative 0.3 NGD seepage rate, and that has been factored into all of the numbers that Kirk presented. And that's about 4% or less than that of your yield. It's very insignificant, not unusual, and we don't recommend any actions at this time.
Amber, if I could add one thing,
yes,
to that. What convinced me that the watershed was not impeded in terms of flow reaching it was the fact that taking the flow record from a larger basin, we used the flow record from the Little River south of here, which is a larger land area, and superimposing that over the smaller drainage basins feed these reservoirs, we were still able to reproduce the drawdown and refilling of the reservoir without having to calibrate the model to that. Being able to show that the reservoir draws down and recovers in a smaller basin using data from a larger basin suggests that the low flow patterns and the high flow patterns, the variability is pretty consistent. And where that would be amplified is in a small basin like these that are heavily impeded. We wouldn't see that kind of drawdown, we wouldn't see that kind of using data from a larger basin. So that's what convinced me, in addition to the initial survey, the fact that we saw the same kind of recovery we would expect with data from a larger basin and a smaller one, persuaded me that the watersheds are not terribly impeded. I think that was an important question.
The gauges and the measurements used, I assume, was in below Thunderbird Dam.
Yes, sir. Yes. Two of them below. And we looked at the incremental difference between the two.
Wide area of
even that is larger than exactly.
The drought management plan. So we've now kind of given you the reservoir yield model, the various operational scenarios. We further use that, as Kirk mentioned, to assign risk based on various demand patterns and starting elevations, and worked closely with city staff to develop a drought management plan that had well-defined triggers and actions. For the commissioners, the drought management plan is summarized on the last page of your handout. This is just to kind of graphically illustrate. It's not to scale, but more information is available. Essentially, there are a couple of things to remember. The drought management plan was based on a risk analysis using the reservoir yield model. Voluntary restrictions occur 2 feet above the West Watkins recreational pool. And water usage restrictions increase as the level increases. So to answer your question, this drought management plan and the levels associated with it are based on current water treatment plant operation. I believe that the period of time in discussion with staff, there was a sedimentation basin that was in operation at the water treatment plant that is no longer used, which caused a higher water surface elevation and a difference in head. So when you take that basin out of service, you do not have that infrastructure constraint.
All these, this drought management, all these are basically just looking at it. When you go to mandatory, like that, 1, 2, 3, 4, those are just foot difference in that.
Yes, sir.
When the lake is down that low, I mean, I don't know what the water is on bass is, but that's how many feet you're using on a foot. But it seems like you're just, if you don't have any precipitation in that amount of time, you're immediately, within a matter of a few days, you're going to go from level one to level.
We worked with staff to develop those numbers, like I said, based on the risk and the associated volume. What we saw, this study concluded with 2010 data, because that was the data that was available when we started. We did go back and look at the 2011 summer that was asked about earlier, and at that point, based on those water levels, you would not have entered into any restriction, and that bore out. You guys didn't have any problems. From the standpoint of the water availability.
And I think the intent is to have these happen pretty rapidly. What it shows is as you lose that volume and don't gain it back, you want to take more aggressive action as you go. I think it's more on the order of several weeks.
If you didn't take into account anything about purchasing water from a couple of pipelines, you don't want to do that.
No, that's because even at these levels, there's still enough yield in the reservoir to meet the demand in 2016.
Right. And so, you know, we've been talking about the balanced water surface elevation. By switching to a higher yielding scenario, you significantly increase the available amount of water that's available to the city, well beyond what's projected for 2016.
And how did you establish the volume for the lake?
Using area capacity curves that were developed and we extended those.
Yeah, because it's taking steps or anything.
No. Based on some bathymetric data, I believe, that we got from the city, there wasn't significant sedimentation. That wasn't part of this project.
Both lakes are used to some extent for recreation and so forth. Does that increase the sedimentation, or does that increase it?
I may let Kirk answer this question. It's typically more a factor of the surrounding watershed and land.
It's more the frequency of floods that affect the sedimentation, the severity of floods that affect that. The recreation shouldn't have a dramatic impact on sedimentation compared to the floods.
So, and one thing we have encouraged the city staff.
we operate in balance. And as they draw down, they'll draw down together. You have the discretionary option to move away from that at any time during the drought. And we've shown earlier that operate them differently by putting priority on one over the other, your yield can actually go up. So in addition to the conservation, the demand side of the drought, you have at your disposal some supply side options too, simply by managing the priorities of the calls. And that's a discretionary option that you can have.
With that, we'll go back to the slide that we presented earlier, just to kind of summarize things. You saw the information that went into the watershed assessment, the seepage evaluation, the yield model, and then ultimately the drought management plan that resulted in these four scenarios. And as we have said, you only remember two things in this presentation tonight. Shawnee is in a great position. You have enough raw water available, even in the lowest yielding scenario, to meet your 2060 projected demand. That puts you in a great place compared to some of your neighbors. And the other thing is, when you do have a situation that negatively impacts your raw water availability, you now have a drought management plan based on analysis with associated risk that has well-defined triggers and action points. So at this time, we'll take any other questions that you have.
What population rate growth did you use?
We used the demand projections and population projections from the Oklahoma Comprehensive Water Plan.
And if that rate increases by 50%,
you would want to
2060.
We have recommended that the city go back and look at their, let me check my note, look at the 2020, review their drought management plan, and that would account for, you would keep on top of it by adjusting your population based on new historical data. But if you look at some higher yielding scenarios, the difference between balancing the water surface elevations and prioritizing Twin Lakes gets you significantly more raw water availability.
What, but you haven't answered my question as to what the population growth rate that you use to extract them.
I don't have that number on hand. That we, like I said, we took the population projection from the statewide water plan.
Corollary question. Is it based, are your projection, demand projections based solely on population growth, or do you take into account industrial development as well?
We took the population and water demand projections from the statewide water plan. Those, we did not do those projections ourselves, and they were not part of the study.
They should be available. That's,
yes, it's available in the central region report. Mm-hmm. It's on the OWRB website. Yes.
Stand here and say that you're still good even if global climate patterns change drastically, because there's no way we can predict that. There is a science to predicting climate change, and if you had 50 experts in the room, they'd all probably point in a different direction. And so what we generally do in studies like this is, to answer your question directly, we did not account for climate change or make any assumptions about climate change, but made sure that we included droughts of different types and severity in the 50-year record. So there are some droughts that are long, prolonged droughts that are marked by gradually increasing deficit in rainfall, and then there are droughts that are very sudden and severe, marked by a very quick shutting off the taps of rainfall. Okay. So in doing that, we've kind of simulated a broad range of different types of droughts, and we've seen that they affect the system differently, but that you're buffered against that with these numbers. We did not look at future climate change. It wasn't part of our charter in this. I think you can see, though, that if you know that under the most conservative set of assumptions and operating guidelines, you have enough to meet the demand projections for your next 50 years, and that if you relax some of those, you still have this water reserve sort of as an emergency, if you wanted to call it that. But that's actually there, it's available. By discretion, we decided to cap it here by balancing those reservoirs, but it's actually there. If you wanted to use it and unbalance the reservoirs, you have it. So there is some buffering there against things like climate change, against things like more accelerated population growth. There is a buffer there, and it depends on how the system's operating.
Did you, were you charged at all to look at the matching up the treatment capability? Is this just supply?
It's strictly supply on this side.
They, back at the drought plan, of course, we sell water to water districts and other places, so I didn't notice any recommendation. I assume that the drought plan would be the same thing for them for whenever you start to go level one, level two, level three. And I have one big concern, and that's about not knowing what the depths of the place were, but I'm not concerned about West Watkins as much as I am Lake Number One out here, that the depths are actually what we think they are.
Well, we haven't, again, simulated anything below the intake pipes. So if we're getting to the intake pipe, if we're still being able to draw water into the plants, we know we can get down at least above. Now, there may be some other sedimentation in other areas in the lake that have restricted some of that volume.
What concern may be that might check some of the, like some of the arms or something together. Sedimentation in there might check some of the water on you.
I think the reason we stayed away from that is that we saw that even the risks that we were seeing, even with the triggers in place, didn't create an imminent loss of water unless your demand exceeds this level. And when we saw it exceed that level, there's a risk. There's no question. If you operate this way and your demand exceeds 4.7, there would be a risk. But when it doesn't, we didn't see that need.
What is our current demand at the peak busiest day we had or something? I haven't heard that number. It's just curious.
Summer months, about 7 million gallons.
7 million.
And we accounted for that seasonality in the analysis. So the numbers that we're showing are the annual averages, but we accounted for the seasonality in the analysis.
That's
the season.
The plant.
We can free about 6.8 million gallons a day. We have a million gallon clear well, so your demand, you treat more than your demand is, you've only got a million or so if you're taking it.
Yeah, I'm not sure how I phrase this. Again, getting back to your averages, 4.7, with the industrial loads on the system during the summer, when you're popping 7 million gallons a day, how did you account for that? Well, are there going to be restrictions on the industrial sector or the economy during hot summers when you're popping the 7?
Yeah, if you look at the detailed recommendations for each level, there are different recommendations for residential and commercial water users. They get more stringent the lower down you go on the scale. So there are differences in the expectations. And they're fairly standard, the same kinds of restrictions that you've seen in other places.
Okay, but again, you're basing this on a 4.7 average, not the serious demands during the summer, right?
But the demands during the summer are accounted for in that. In other words, the risks that we looked at to develop the triggers included the peaking in the summer, both for the residential and commercial side. We used some historical data.
Yes. And the drought management plan, we focused tonight on the raw water side because that's what we were tasked with. The drought management plan does factor in limitations based on treatment plant capacity.
Actually,
Brian
just did. Okay.
commission will have to establish at what level that we would wanna go out and purchase the water from. I told her why we had to go all the way to the most severe restriction.
And that was really my question, I think, back to staff is, kinda like what James was saying, is now that we have this study, which we've had, I guess, in our hands for what, 10 days now or something, are you gonna review this and look at the drought management plan and then make some recommendations? One, based on whether or not some of these numbers, the 1055 is actually something that we want to be able to live with and you can actually treat if that's in the middle of the summer. Would you make a recommendation that at a certain level we purchase additional water? Right now that would be, you know, possibly through Atoka. And even, you know, whether or not, the big question looming is whether or not the expenditure to connect Atoka is still something that's that we should even be considering right now. Or can we take that off the table?
My opinion, if you look and understand that the most worst case scenario would have enough water, and then you've got these others that you can do by the way you operate the lakes to have this buffer above the red line here. I can see a Atoka coming in the picture. And even when we did do it last time, it was to help that much.
Well, I agree with that, but you can't predict Mother Nature, so that's what I'm concerned about is based on past history or on whatever might happen in the future, but we've seen some pretty severe droughts where the fortune we didn't have to go up to the last level on our own, you know, previous way. But they could keep the some type of lake level up, I think we can better, you know, take a look at the Atoka line and purchase some water from Atoka.
And do we still pay our valve fee or whatever it is meter. So that our meter fee so that should we ever decide to enact that, we can. That's our insurance policy for that water probably.
And I think you can look at even West Watkins in sort of the same way. It has not been used aggressively. Some of these historical droughts. And now in the last few years, you've started to use it more aggressively and negatively. And that's substantially increased your yield. And that's a chunk of this excess.
A question is, if I remember on one of your previous slides, the recreational fuel is 1062 at West Watkins, but your trigger is at 1055, is that right?
One of the triggers. The triggers start at 1064. So 2 feet before you reach the recreational pool, you start to institute some voluntary restrictions, and then they progress from there. But I think 1055 is the lowest.
Level four
mandatory restrictions.
And at level, I believe it's level two, the city has recognized that it may be necessary to withdraw water from the West Watkins Recreation after getting.
Because the way it's set up is to try to leave the recreation for West Watkins.
Right.
Alone.
And it needs to be on the table.
Yeah, my memory of the 95 plant, which technically I guess was just superseded, showed 1.8 MGD out of West Watkins sustainable yield. So you've adjusted off of that. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yeah, I think when you look at
West Watkins
alone, I think the number was about 3. We put the permit conditions on it. We put actual available water to Shawnee. We looked for the assumptions and the hydrologic basis for that earlier study too. We looked for that too. I could not find the basis for that. So we recreated the hydrology.
For one thing, that in 95 we didn't, we doubled the size of the line from the Twin Lakes back to the water line.
Right.
So when on the drawdown when it increased, it's not quite double, but it would increase that much.
But you're saying is that there's a difference in the yield that we're projecting from West Watkins versus the earlier study.
That's correct.
The yield definition is also different.
That's true.
The yield definition in the 95 study is not the same yield definition that is used here.
What's the difference?
I don't recall offhand, but there is a difference in how that is calculated and defined based on percentage.
we look for the data to try to justify or rectify that. I could not.
I guess there's a standard measure then, or a standard method of calculating the larger water, where it takes in the water as compared to the water. And they've got a ratio or percentage or...
Well, that's more of a hydraulic issue. It is, you can regulate that flow at the intake. If you have more capacity, you can take more out on a daily basis, but it wouldn't be sustainable necessarily over the course of the year.
But again, I guess it's up to the commission to make the decision at what level, and then you want to buy water. I don't want to draw it down to level two, I mean level three for sure.
Yeah.
When you determine the recreational pool and the amount of water available to Shawnee, I assume you deducted 15% that Tecumseh owns in that pool?
Yes. Yeah, sure does. We put constraints on West Watkins in three ways. One is the recreational pool, one is the 0.7 MGD Tecumseh, and one is the actual permit for taking water out of West Watkins. And all of those are in front of you.
Do we have any idea, Brian, on the data or how far back the data is on the depth and so forth?
The city engineering department actually went out and did that a couple of different times, James, and didn't find significant sedimentation in that. One thing that we didn't mention that causes a lot of sedimentation in the reservoir is a lot of development around it. The city's kind of insulated itself a little bit in that we have city limits that actually surround the immediate areas of the lake, which we can determine whether or not the developer or builder of those lots is actually appropriately keeping their sedimentation on the lot that they're developing. We don't have any control of anything outside of the city limits. If there were large developments that came in around those reservoirs inside of those basins where the stormwater comes from, that would probably cause it. I think to answer your question, city engineers in the back, you might be able to answer a little bit more about that.
The good thing about that, what part of the vessel city limits are required by the way for how we go.
So we'll get that information to you.
I remember when that was, John.
It was 2004, 2005, about then. It's five. We took like 600-700 points out there. GPS to measure the depth in the lake, and then of course plotted it, determined the volumes based on area and elevation. So found that the rate of sedimentation was actually decreasing. The rate of sedimentation was actually decreasing from previous studies. And the reason why we did that, because there was talk about the lake silting in. So we did that just to see how much percentage of volume it was losing, and found that the lake is really, based on the rate of sedimentation, will last probably about 320 years, basically what it was designed for.
Where the city should go. While that is very very good. There have been those meetings not all of us can go to. They're not public meetings. And so this is also a public meeting where some of these things can be discussed. We're going to keep it very, very informal. And we're not going to have a timer. We're not going to do anything like that. We're not going to, you know, hold you to a time. We do ask that if you have some comments, that you stand up and at least tell us your name. Hopefully your information is out there on the sheet when you signed up, so we don't have to stop for Phyllis to get information. But just for the record, we need to know who's speaking. The other thing is that there are some of those that are concerned, because we are in an election, that this can get to be campaign platforms and just basically, you know, the need for that. That's not what this purpose is. We want to hear from everybody. Everybody in this room probably has some ideas of what we may need to do to move forward and how we get there. Or maybe we don't. Maybe that's the idea too. But really, just want to open it up for discussion. If you don't have anywhere to start, I've got some questions. But please start anybody, anything about not just part of these list, but anything that you might want to bring up. We are in the middle of a budget process. I mean, this is budget season right now. So if some things come out that need to be planned for right now in a sequencing method, maybe for years, or to start something so that grants or something else can be applied for soon, we need to go ahead and get some of those projects rolling, if that's the idea that actually pans out on some of these. So I'll just open it up without saying anything else. Does anybody want to start? Okay.
I just have a quick question. My name is Lakeisha Meek. Which park is the community park referring to?
Lakeisha Meek.
Lakeisha Meek.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Which park is this community park referring to?
Let's say it's the sports park.
Okay. What is the sports park?
The item that was on the ballot for sales tax, I would assume, on February 14th.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
Okay. All right. Anything else?
Well, I'll start it out. Since the election on February the 14th, I've been trying to save kind of the capital outlay money and divert it to the repair. We received an estimate of about $600,000 to renovate the pool with, and that's one thing I've tried to do. And I'm just wondering how much interest is there in restoring the pool, or not restoring the pool and adding a spray park to it, or, you know, what's the situation?
Is there anybody here that's been part of some grassroots effort on the pool just recently in the last couple of weeks? Is that what you're referring to? Because there have been some people that have been meeting and talking about that. Is anybody here part of that group? Because that's a really good question.
If you're looking for some input on that, I think that this community is large enough and a varied economic structure that we have to have a community pool. And places that require membership are great, and they're wonderful options, and we have several of those. But that community pool, I think, is a very important thing for the city of Shawnee. And the one that we have is in, to say the least, it's in disrepair. And it had a leak for a long time, which I believe was repaired, but it just needs to be upgraded so that more people can use it, and so that it's not a danger to the people that are city employees that are putting the system to use.
Do you think it's important that the pool is where it is right now, or in the community where it is right now?
Well, let me say that if you're doing some construction for the pool, we were looking at the possibility of doing a geothermal system at the municipal auditorium, and we found that there is a space that's a large enough well field
that I think would be able to support the pool as well. So, I mean, it might be a bonus to have them together.
To make it year-round, or to heat the pool?
Well, to start the season a little bit sooner, surely. You know, at least to be able to use it on weekends.
I would like to see a year-round pool with maybe a bubble over it. I don't think bubbles cost that much, because I mean, opening the pool is very expensive, closing the pool is very expensive, and people would like to exercise year-round and swim year-round, not just during the summer. And I think that'd be great to cover.
That would be cool too.
And then you can take it down in the summertime. The bubble's optional.
So, do you think that? Because I totally agree. I live downtown. I like to use the pool for training.
Oh,
sorry,
okay.
Holly Worden.
Thank you.
Sorry.
And before that was Kay Joyce.
I got you.
Get Kay.
Thank you. Sorry. I agree. And I think maybe that you would possibly hit a different demographic market that wouldn't be just necessarily kids out of school during the summertime. That would be your senior citizens,
and that
would be me downtown. I would really prefer to keep it local and just ride my bike down to the pool and swim there, and then go out to St. Gregory's. I love St. Gregory's, but
it's a long way out there.
Marta?
Marta Less. I mean, there's a big line of kids and people wanting to get into that pool. So I know that that pool is used by the people of Shawnee, the citizens who can't go to the country club, who can't go to the Elks, who don't have a way to maybe get transportation. And those kids ride their bikes, they walk, they come as families, they do picnic lunches, that pool is used. I would hate to see it move from the historic location and the location, which seems to be in the center of town. I realize that the community is stretching out, which happens with development, but I feel like a majority of the people that use the pool are people who don't have a way to get someplace else.
If we were, just throwing it out, I know we're not gonna resolve anything right here. If we were to partner with someone else in town and the pool would be located, say, about where the expo is, do you think we just lost the purpose of the pool?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. So its location is real important. Downtown.
Yes.
Yeah. Wes?
You know, I had a policeman tell me, he said, if you don't open that pool, you have no idea what vandalism and how much is going to occur. Because those kids have to do something. And the pool keeps them active. And I thought that was an interesting statement. They do. These are kids that, they don't have anything else to do in the summer except either swim or get in trouble.
The other conversation that's taken place is, should it be a splash pad instead of a pool?
Can't we have both?
Yeah. Okay, but not a splash pad instead of.
No.
That's part of the discussion that's taking place now too.
We have people that go from here that Seminole has a pool, and they also have a splash pad, and we have people that drive to here to Seminole to play in the splash pad, and then also swim.
I do. Those same kids that I take to swimming lessons at the municipal pool, some of them are too little to do that, so we go to the splash pad in Seminole because it's the closest one, and I don't have to watch the little ones quite as close. So it's great. It would be great to have both. But.
And isn't the splash pad, there's no charge to do that, is there?
No, not in Seminole. It's just, no, it's open.
You can call me in.
Yeah, Douglas Gordon. Great to call me. I think a pool, a year-round one, would be a good idea, especially with Shawnee being a certified healthy community. There's more places for people to go to stay fit. And I work with COFA, and we're towards helping build healthier communities. I think the pool would certainly help towards that. And as Wes said, it gives the youth something to do, somewhere to go, and not great balance.
Anyone else?
Teresa
Cody. I just have a question. What is the city's budget for the pool each year? Or has there ever been a real budget for that pool?
There's not really a budget for the pool. We do budget for the chemicals that we use and for the electricity and some of the manpower down here. But as far as doing anything for the pool to repair it, it just comes out of our repair maintenance budgets.
So there's really not a maintenance program, per se?
Not really, no.
Well, we've got to do in the past, and every time we have a need, last year, James, we spent $250,000 or $300,000 on the pump, on the drainings and stuff like that. So
yeah, it was around $264,000 or $246,000 to do all the filtration in the basement. That we would have probably had to shut down before now.
But there's never been any money spent on the building or the restrooms or any of those kind of things that should have been maintained every year.
So when we took our tours 3 years ago and we went to all the facilities, James, didn't you have a list of the things that needed to be improved? Or do you bring that to the budget every year that says now, and it may be because it's at critical mass, it may not be that we're working through a regular maintenance plan and we're now on step 7 this year. But how do you work out maintenance for that in the plan?
I mean, I submit a lot of things every year for the budget just because, I mean, there are so many buildings and so many parks and things that not everything gets funding for repair. I mean, the main thing that we try to do each year is the critical areas. The pool is our critical area right now. Other than we finally are getting a lot of resources.
So, yes, Holly?
So then my question would be, now we know that we've been we don't necessarily have a standing line item budget because, as you said, we're just doing critical things as needed. Does anyone know what the actual bottom line to redo the pool, do it the way it's supposed to be done, refurbish it, because it's a historic place, like Marta was saying. Do we have a number? Do we have a budget or an estimate?
Diane, the staff brought a figure back to us, about a month ago, and it was $570,000, James, or like close to $600,000.
Yeah, and that's just to do repairs. That's not to do the whole mess. I mean, you want to do the whole mess, we're talking about $3 million, which came out of a study that we done on the pool that told us what we needed to repair and also gave us some ideas of putting some things in there to dress the thing up, give some more activities than just standing in the water.
The figure that James presented to the commission in March basically was filtration in terms of at the pool, because right now we have lines that run under the decks that are out there that have come apart over the 4 years that it's been out there, so it adds more sedimentation to the pool. It's about putting a rail around it. The plan that James is talking about is a zero entry pool for ADA requirements. That's one of the biggest things that we have that's an issue out there. The inside of the building is not ADA accessible. The pool is not ADA accessible. We have to actually take our disabled individuals and put them down into the water with a chair system, hydraulic chair system. But the number that James submitted was I think the roof.
Yeah, on parts of the figure it was. I mean, just the basis, like I say, the opening pool up in 2013.
That was the basis to what would it take to open the pool in 2013.
Right.
That's the pool as it is right now.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, I mean, like with the $600,000 in repairs.
Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. See, what we're up against comes in and reviews pools. And so they're not only looking at filtration and making sure the chemicals are correct, they're making sure it's accessible for all members of our society, whether you're in a wheelchair or you're in crutches or whatever. So we still have lead showers built. Showers were built, you know, in the 40s too with gang showers. We need to change that so they're individual shower stalls. When you come into the facility, there's no ADA accessibility. When you go from the main area into the showers or the restrooms, there's no ADA accessibility because there's a lip on there. So it's almost to the point where when we go in to look at these things, if we're making those changes, you have to think, you have to wonder about what do we really need to do to make it ADA accessible? Because if we do the 550, like Commissioner Harrod mentioned, and then you want to, then in 2013 to get it open, then what they're going to do is then in 2014, they're going to come out and say, okay, what's your plan for making it ADA accessible? What's your plan for making sure that those gang showers are not appropriate and you're going to fix those? So it's just a list that, and they're okay with that as long as you get on a plan. But when we go from the 525 and we start busting up concrete in floors and things like that, then our expenses for repairing the facility will go up. And we still don't have the zero entry pool that would allow everybody to go in. And that was one of the most desirable things that we really wanted to have, was that whether you were a toddler or you were in a wheelchair, you were in a zero entry situation where you slid right into the pool.
I know that would be helpful for a lot of my seniors, because we had one summer where we had a contract with the Y for the seniors to be able to use the pool in the mornings that they weren't doing the swimming lessons, and they loved it. But I mean, we're not able to do that anymore. They didn't have the staff available in the last couple of years for us to do.
Which brings me right. Is there anyone here from the Y board, by any chance?
I have a suggestion. I read in the council paper where the hospital is going to have a $100 million endowment for the health of people in Shawnee. Let's get $3-4 million from them and fix the pool.
There you go.
I mean, to me, they're talking about the Noble Foundation, some of the other foundations, is they're going to have as much money as they have. Why not put it back into our community?
Well, that leads into quality of life. Just like Wes was saying, it's something for our youth, this is something for our seniors, and our community as a whole. Mm-hmm. It's not just one segment.
Going to be available. I don't have that much. I don't have that kind of information. But I don't think it was in the John A. paper, but it was in the council paper, the countywide, that they have set up $100 million trust as of July 1st, and it's for health. And that seems like a good solution to me.
They said it was going to take about a year to.
Well, if we can get by the 2012 and do some repairs and enough to get started on 2013, then we can start making an application. That's something, of course, the hospital was originally, I think, the city hospital, and then it was transferred to doctor, and we, our attorney and attorneys went through all of that. So, but anyhow, we don't have any vested interest in it, so. But we could receive some of that. If you know somebody on that trust board, then we could. That'd be a good project for them.
Mm-hmm.
James, if I might,
on that board.
Oh,
finally,
sounds like.
Got my ears burning.
Sorry, Mike.
Mike, we should have 108. We've already had four people come to us about. Many of us big as all the way. We're basically the kind of
I've worked with the Noble Foundation, the Sarkey Foundation, some of them, so. That's why I was suggesting that.
Yeah. And I was asking for the why, just because if, as we continue to go 1 year at a time, they have an investment that they make too as a board, because at this point, it's not profitable to them to manage that facility for the 3 or so months that we do that. So it's an investment on their part, and I have asked them, and I thought it was at this the April board meeting, if they would discuss, you know, what they were willing to do, and what could they do this year, and then what could they do next year, and what are the types of things that we would have to have that would help them so that their investment doesn't have to be at the same level it always has been. So just to have somebody to manage it is costing that entity right now. So if we had another, I mean, if there was another option to do that, we could talk about that. Right now, for the immediate future of, you know, this summer and possibly next, is what we're looking at is who can manage that facility for us. And are they willing to invest, you know, from their standpoint? So we probably haven't had that yet. Yes, John?
One way we could save money is make it a salt water pool rather than a chlorine pool. Mm-hmm. I don't know if James has looked into that. Or
if it was year-round, that would be a great alternative, right. But it just mm-hmm. being 3 months out of season.
Well, I think we still need to take an eye, keep an eye on the capital outlay and to make sure that we can make it through 2013 or 2014, whenever those applications or grants are going to be available or whatever they are. But I mean, we need to watch our capital expenses until that time.
And I don't know what the purpose of this activated group is that's a safe pool.
I've not had any contact
of one person who's on it, so I don't know what their means are either. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't either.
So, yeah.
Well, in lieu of grants or community foundation investing, are there other ideas in the room for funding what basically is a $3 million investment?
One of the things that I know other cities do is they use a portion of their hotel motel tax to help pay for the parks. And I understand that the hotel motel tax in Shawnee right now is fairly low. I'm Linda AG, I'm sorry. It's fairly low. So there may be some room there to look at that. I know it would have to go to other people. But according to the last election, the municipal pool and the 911 communications were two of the things I think that were the most popular with the people. So that's something to consider.
Do you think it would be more popular to fund it, or at least the operations, through a bed tax, an additional one, or a portion of what we have now? Do you think that might be more palatable?
I don't know. I hadn't thought about operations. I was thinking more about maintenance and upkeep, and I mean improvements.
Same. Okay.
Right.
Not just the initial capital investment, but the ongoing, some of that too.
And not just the pool, but the parks in general.
Right.
If not anything else, it could free up some additional money. If we used it for salaries and out at the expo, or used it out on the expo, we could save $500,000 a year on, or whatever we save, you know, on employees and things like that. And we could use it then for, you know, other purposes, such as a pool or streets or whatever, you know, anything.
You think that's an option to do short term right now?
Yeah.
Without an addition?
We were talking the other day, and I think Dallas-Fort Worth area, you're talking anywhere from 11 to 12% for room tax. And I think Tulsa is what, 10 or 11? Anybody? Last time I was up there, I think it was 8. What is ours?
5.
5.
So if you raise it to 8 or 10%, you double your revenue immediately.
Assuming not.
What would that do, Richard, to occupancy? Do you think if we had a 10% occupancy tax?
Well, I don't know. I
we're on the topic, it's not anything that we had asked the voters for right now, is an increase in that, or a portion of what is there right now. I mean, the expo is considered tourism right now. Do you think it's appropriate to divide the funds that go to the CVB as we know it and to the expo operations as we know it?
I wouldn't want to without increasing the percentage.
And although it's not quite that collection is not quite $500,000 a year, but let's just say 1% is $100,000. Let's just say, because it's at 5%, so because it's like what, 440 or 460 right now, which is what it brings in. So just for conversational purposes, so that you can think if our operations at the expo, if the city currently pays for the employees at the expo, and that's about $500,000, and that's about what we're talking. So if they paid for the whole thing, that'd be, we have to go up to 10%, or we'd be in that 5% that's currently there and only raise it enough, or it'd be a split.
When we had that election, the reason it ended up at the chamber is because the people that were required to support it, Ken Shrupp and Ken Fulbright and et al., wanted it outside of your all's reach. And that was what we voted on. And I, for one, if you all are going to reach into that pie, I, for one, am going to push to have the people vote on it again. The residents that voted it in want to change the rules, and they're perfectly entitled to do that. I don't think you all are entitled to do that.
What I'm saying is to increase it, say, 8% to 8%, and have a vote to increase it to 3%. To have it go or designate where that 3% goes, and the 5% stays like it is, or something like that. Richard, that's what I'm
saying. I don't know, James. I would think it would dry up your market or something.
Do I?
I would think that would run some of the customers.
You think so?
Mm-hmm. The CVB, and I'm not on that board any longer, but the CVB tries to negotiate with them. If they want to be like the casino hotel, could get in the Visitors Bureau here, but they're going to have to pay to do that. And they've done that a time or two in the past, and I can't tell you exactly who, except one of them was Bobby Trousdale when he opened his thing in Tecumseh. And the board at that time negotiated of what would amount to a room tax. I don't remember the amount or how it was even done, but I would think that the more you raise that, the less likely you would be able to get the Potawatomis and other hotels that are going to be around the area to participate. And I think we need to view them more as a partner and maybe less of an adversary. I know we don't always do that, but I know sometimes we do.
We can probably check that out with them. I don't know what their plans are or anything. I've talked to Dr. Rocky about that. And I've had lengthy discussions in the last 2 or 3 weeks, but that's not one of them.
So you asked about additional funding.
Other sources.
Hotel motel tax was brought up for either parks, infrastructure, capital improvements, or operations, maintenance, or expo operations, capital improvement too, James, or just operations? Anybody else got any other thing that they're interested in hotel motel tax?
That'd just be for operations. By 1 cent sales tax is for capital improvement, that's the purpose of the 1 cent sales tax.
Yeah, Douglas Gordon again. I think we should maybe raise the hotel motel tax for things like our emergency communication towers, radios, etc. Because that's going to keep the whole community safe, and surrounding communities, and people coming to the hotels will also be safe. I think it was rather ridiculous that come that last election, all right, I can understand people weren't in favor of the ballpark, but to do a blanket no against everything, including the emergency communication tower, I mean, as a citizen of Shawnee for the last 13 years, I was kind of appalled at that. And I think we should find the money somewhere, whether it be raising the bed tax by 1 or 2%. I mean, I enjoy living in Shawnee. Even with my Scottish accent, I intend to be around here a lot longer. And I want to be safe.
There's a reason that I was opposed to the 911 is because we have too many entities that are using the 911 tower, not the 911 service like the answering the phone or anything, but use the tower and don't contribute anything to the cost of the equipment or the tower or anything else. And the county government does, all the county sheriff does, the county commissioners do, the CPN does, the Kickapoos do, Sac and Fox, you know, I mean, we could make a list, I think probably, you know, 15 or 20 people that ought to be contributing into the cost of that tower other than just the citizens of Shawnee paying for it 100% and let them ride free in one sense of the word. If we're going to spend $8 or $9 million or $6 million on the tower and the radios and stuff like that, somebody ought to help pay for it.
Does the state use it too, Jim?
Do what? The
state of Oklahoma use it?
Yeah, Iowa Patrol uses it.
I mean, I would see where upgrade, and if they want to continue to use it, say, okay, we've got a better tower now, let's, you want to continue using it, put something in.
So is that like the chicken or the egg? We can ask everybody to participate and then build it, or we can build it and then charge them for participation. Did I say that right?
Rent.
Yeah.
Problem is that they all have the same frequencies and they all do, so if you don't get them committed before you build it, how are you going to start charging them for using it?
But we've got people at risk in this community with communication problems.
It's been that way for 25 years.
Okay, but...
We
know where it is now, and we know the people that are living in places that are subject to those blackouts. And that's not a real healthy way to grow a community, is having part of our community not...
Every officer has a cell phone.
Well, okay.
Almost every officer has a cell phone.
I'm going to step in here for Jeff.
Yeah.
I've been knee-deep in this since this morning and stuff. I met with we started meeting the E911 board this morning. They didn't have a quorum, so we kind of sat off in the corner and chatted for a bit. Okay. This is a much more complicated issue, and I'll soon gather my expertise and have to rely on Don Lynch some on this. I will tell you that we are one of the first communities to enter into the 800 system as part of the statewide system. So, but with that, when we did that, Shawnee wasn't nearly as large as it is now. Okay. The tower at the time when it was built, like most things we build for the current need and not the future need. So at this point though, we've outgrown our radio system. So yes, other people do use the system, but in that regard, we also use other party systems as we travel about. So, should we be asking people to pay? That's way above my decision. But we also have the use of other people's power.
I understand that.
So, but what I can tell you is that we have outgrown our communication system. So, whether or not we merge the two dispatch centers, you know, whether or not anybody else pays or not, I can tell you, Shawnee has a real need to solve the communication problem. Okay. Now, a person asked me at the first of this meeting before we got started, where do the dead spots start? MacArthur North. Okay. And there's some significant areas as you go further north. Okay. When we go
towards the west, there's some spots out that way. You go far enough west, you start hitting Open City Towers, which we are part of that statewide network. Now then, it's my understanding that the state has tried to do the I-44 corridor. It's not bad. I can go down the lot and talk about it here. Okay. Our problem is the north side of town. Now then, that does affect police, fire, react, sheriff, and anybody that might help respond on the north side of town. Unfortunately, I wish we had a simple answer to this question as far as the funding goes. The simple answer is yes, we need a tower on the north side of town. Okay, that's the answer. Now, the bigger question is how do we fund it and who should fund it, which is way above my pay grade. All I know is that when I key this up, I need to be able to talk to somebody. And I'll tell you that over this weekend, officer make a traffic stop in a very high traffic volume area of the city on the north side of town. Got nothing. If you say the answer is cell phone, I'm going to tell you right now, you're wrong. And I know I work for you, but that's the wrong answer. I feel that strongly about it. So I'm going to put my foot down, and this is where I put my foot down. Cell phone is not the right answer.
So wouldn't you say, though, that knowing that your radio works, and if you get highway patrolmen, you get another Shawnee officer, you get an absentee Shawnee tribal officer, you get a CPN officer, you get somebody on that radio, you don't care who it is that's going to come provide you backup, that tower's worth it.
Oh, exactly. My butt's getting kicked. I don't care who comes. Does every other officer that might be bumping off that tower. Now what's funny is you get very far north and you start getting out of the range of our tower, the next tower it starts bumping off of is Kearney. It starts trying to hit the Kearney tower. Now somebody tell me how far Kearney is.
44 miles.
40 miles.
Okay.
I know exactly how far it is.
So,
but what I'm saying,
but it doesn't
Chandler,
make, it doesn't
Chandler doesn't have a tower, Craig doesn't have a tower.
They're on different systems, sir.
But they're all going to this system.
That's
my understanding, that they're all supposed to go on the
We've got people on 800, 700, VHF,
UHF,
conglomeration. They're all, and we're all supposed to be digital, too. Not everybody's meeting that mandate. We're all supposed to be narrow-banded. That's still in progress. Although I think that I think this county's probably ahead of the game on that. I was going to say, you're now starting to jump in here.
I'm just going to jump in here. Just the benefit for interoperability. Chief is talking about operability, day-to-day operations. I want to give you an example of how interoperability helps. This morning, the sheriff's office got in pursuit of the suspect that was involved in a suspected burglary in the county. Sheriff's deputy was following them. It was two vehicles identified. Two vehicles split once they recognized that the sheriff's deputy was following them. So the deputy got in pursuit one way, called for backup. There were other deputies that were headed to assist her with that issue. I'm monitoring not only that channel, but I'm also monitoring Shawnee PD's channel. Shawnee PD officer got on there, who happened to be out around the lake, and contacted his shift supervisor and said, are you monitoring what the county's doing? He said, no, it didn't happen to me at the time. So he explained and got permission to assist in that event that was taking place that actually wound up inside Shawnee City Limits at the lake. That's the benefit of having those people being able to talk to each other. It's a better response to everybody in the county, not just the citizens of Shawnee. They can help each other just like that. McLeod was able to come down and help the county with the other suspect car as well, because they're part of the system. So there is some benefits to having interoperability between all of those responding agencies who are working in our community together.
So Don, the magic number to do what we need to do, sans the 911 center, just to get our tower and our radios up to speed is?
You're looking at $1.5 million to put up a north tower in the north part of Shawnee. I would ask you for another million to upgrade our tower, because our tower, the current tower that we have, the equipment that's in there is meeting the end of life expectations, and we're going to have to replace it. It's going to take about $1 million to do that. So we're asking for $2.5 million for that package.
To keep this cop that's got on a traffic stop from getting shot and not being able to call.
I can't keep him from getting shot, but I can help him get assistance when he needs it.
You need to be able to reach somebody. And it's the same with React. It's the same with the fire department. And to this morning was a perfect example of why the two centers, why we need to have one joint dispatch center, because we're trying to listen on two different channels. The two dispatchers are having to pick up the phone, one in one center, one in the other, and talk to each other, tell each other what's going on, instead of being in the same room going, hey, my person's here, where's your person? Oh, they're here. And it's that, what you gain by that is efficiency. And thank you, Commissioner, for attending tonight. We talked this morning.
So are there some other funding options out there, or are there some things that Shawnee can be the first money in, and then we would have matching funds? Is there something, can we do a tower for $1.5 million, and then 3 years later do the upgrades? I don't know. I'm just asking for other alternatives.
We still have about 3 years on end of life before we're going to have to look at completely upgrading the tower we've got here. So if you do $1.5 million to start with, a couple of years you're going to need the other million to take a look at starting that upgrade process. So
now we have lost.
I'm down one transmitter right now. You cannot buy the replacement transmitters yet. They're not going to be manufactured until 2013, fourth quarter. So that's why I'm saying 2 years down the road. That I'm looking for a good used transmitter on the market to get us through that time being right now until we get there.
So the current tower has
seven transmitters. It's
supposed to have seven transmitters. We're down to
six.
We're down to six.
No
replacement.
Anybody approach the county about part of the 110 sales tax?
I am not. We've been in talks with the county 911 about combining the centers, and that's that would be the best thing possible for the citizens of this county. How do we merge these two together?
Why can't we get all these people that use it together in one room and see what you can come up with?
It's funny that you say that, sir, because that's what we talked about.
And I'll step up and say something now, more serious, but that's exactly why we tried to get here tonight, is to say, let's get the county commissioners, the 911, and the city commissioners in a room together, and let's get it all on top of the table, and let's see what we can do.
I agree. Management, everything. responders that are coming into your area if you have a natural disaster will need that operability care.
I agree. Butch Victor, I agree with you. The quicker response that you can have through all departments, the more lives you're going to save.
That's what we're here, I mean, that's what we're in the business about, is serving and saving lives, so.
Melissa, can you set that meeting up between the two entities and whoever else needs to be there? Allow us to talk about the dispatch center too, not just communication hours probably, so that the conversation can go either way.
Sure.
And try to do it as soon as probably the majority of us can get together so that we do this expeditiously.
Now, would you guys rather do it of an evening time like this, or does it matter?
Whenever you decide.
Okay.
Yeah, that's fine.
I'll do that.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Anything else? You ready to take a break? Been here almost 2 hours. Cool, and E911. From those two, that's pretty, I think we had a pretty good start on some things that we might be able to take action on, hopefully, relatively soon. Anybody else got a burning topic that they just want to say before we...
I do.
Go for it, Kate.
I have a burning topic, and I'm Kate Joyce with the Shawnee Senior Center, and we also hold the city contract for the municipal auditorium management. And that is the most magnificent building. And at some point in the very near future, if we don't do something to put a central heat and air system in there and, just get that online, we're going to have to shut that building down because there'd be no point in going forward. We don't have three-phase electric. We don't have a central heat and air system. We've gone through all of the expense, or the city has gone through all of the expense of putting in a fire suppression system. And we've been taking some of the funds that we've acquired from renting the facility and been doing some cosmetic upgrades. But the senior center doesn't have the money to put in that central heat and air system. Now, we submit a packet every year to the city for a contract review. And last year when we submitted our packet for review, it was with the hope that the central heat and air system would be installed and that we could use the rental income that we would have received from the municipal auditorium to support staff growth. And that did not happen. The city has $150,000 sitting in a fund to put a central heat and air system in that building, and each year that number is diminished by the amount it's going to cost to put the central heat and air system in. So I would like to propose that we move forward with getting that project completed.
We bid on it this year, didn't we, James? We put out for bid for central heat and air.
Yeah, we tried.
Yeah.
And it's larger than the amount that we
the money Kate's talking about, since there's just no funding in any of these areas, we have to try to put a little bit back every year and save for 2 or 3 years till we come up with the amount that it takes to do these projects. And we tried, and the contractors really didn't like it. So we've kind of stepped back, and Kate's been helping out a whole lot. We've looked at different options with the geothermal, and I bet we've had at least three different types of people in there looking at the space and trying to get a good idea of how best to do that. So, but it's going to take quite a large sum. It's a large building.
It'll probably take total about $500,000, don't you think? Because to put the central heat and air system in, you have to do the electrical upgrade to three-phase.
The three-phase is downtown Shawnee. Almost every building in downtown Shawnee has just Delta three-phase, so Delta three-phase is not a big deal.
Well, I'm glad you think so.
I know so. I know so. That's how I made my living for 13 years.
But while you're
having help.
What you're talking about is how we have operated for a long time, and that was part of up what we could to buy and improve what we can. There are some projects that are larger than what we can save up in a foreseeable future to spend relatively soon before the costs just get totally out of hand. I think when we started yours, we were talking about $200,000 for that particular part of that improvement.
That's correct.
Right. And we probably didn't say this was like a $3 million improvement, like we're talking about the pool over here.
Right.
But we're doing the municipal auditorium in $200,000 increments, but it's taken us 4 years almost to get $200,000. We get $200,000, we put the sprinkler system in. Now we get $150,000 and it's not enough. $200,000 is not going to get the heat and air. So now we're up against, we need more than what we can save, or what we can put aside this year, or what we've been putting aside. You're saying we're at a critical point now almost to get that done.
Yeah, I think, you know, the James has toured everybody on the building that wanted to go on a tour, so you know what condition the furnace is in. And, I mean, you have to stand back, the thing blows fire. It's an awesome sight, it looks like a dragon.
One of the problems that we've run into is when we took bids on it, we took them on a design build.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the commission's all in agreement now that we need, from now on, we're going to do a design ourselves and then let the bidders have a design and drawings and so forth, specifications to go by, so that it'll even out the field so everybody knows what they're bidding on.
Right. Well, and another thing that I don't know that y'all are aware of or if it's at the forefront, but the Senior Center and Municipal Auditorium are Red Cross shelters. And twice they have been set up because it looked like a tornado, and in one case the ice storm, were coming in and it looked like we would have to use those buildings for shelter. Well, with the, excuse me, with the furnace not being a reliable system, having a room for everybody to sleep in an ice storm and then having the heat go off is not a good thing.
I can back Kate up because last year I tried to have an art show there and it was freezing. Some of the artists, you know, they were wearing 2 or 3 jackets. I mean, like, that's potential revenue. Like, other people could rent if the heating was set up, so city could get some of the money back by the senior center.
Either or.
Okay.
All right. Any other burning issue besides the municipal auditorium?
Yes. Okay. I'll have to see how the grid. I'm going to complicate things, but it seems to me that on the list that at least was on the agenda, kind of left off of education. And I know that it's not necessarily the city's job to take it on. We've seen what's happened in the city. We've had math programs. Basically turned that city around in the last 2 years. And the funding mechanisms are complicated. The state has all kinds of rules. But it seems to me if we started a dialogue, we talked about this, but if we started a dialogue with the school board, and we have a specific problem in this community, and that is the independent schools, concentrating deeply for our high school. The nice little high school, first economic development, and that the chamber's got a huge mandate for education. It seems to me the next time we go out to vote, we just include something for education. You know, you get the kind of groundswell behind this thing, and I think we're talking to the school board to see how we can help them, how we better use their funds to do what they are. I mean, look at our high school, it's kind of embarrassing. I've had Dr. Whitlock say, if he's got a recruit that's a professor that has junior high kids, he knows he's going to get them because we drive by the junior high and they come. If he's got high school kids and professors, you know where they go. You've got that kind of wow effect on our high school. If there's anything that we as a city
city, we as citizens can do, we need to do. So I don't know where it goes on that list, but sure like to stay on it.
Let me clear up something about the list. I made the list. Somebody said, post an agenda. And so we want to talk about, so that's why it says, including without limitation, I made a laundry list and I sent it to Phyllis. This was just get something out so that we can have a wide range of discussion. It wasn't meant to specifically include or exclude anything. So that's on me.
Educationally, y'all tried to have meetings, haven't you, with different boards and stuff? And
we started again back there. Seems to be a great deal of interest.
Oh, and there was too.
Yeah. Joe?
Kind of piggyback on that, Joe Ford. I'm on the 10-year planning committee for the Shawnee School System right now. And they've contracted some architects to look at all the facilities, look at the growth patterns of students in our schools. And it's the budgets are very tight. Property taxes that fund I-93 are going to be spread very thin to go across all those buildings. Jefferson, Horseman, we all have been around those schools. And, you know, they're very old. Things like ADA has been talked about tonight. Those are some things that have to be addressed in some of those buildings. But I think this, if the town can work together on those facilities, I think there could be some planning that some city improvements go along at the same time as some school system improvements, and we kind of build on some of those areas that need to be really highlighted for our community, like the high school area. That's a large piece of property, but there's going to be a lot of needs at that there. So that 10-year plan should be done. I hate to put a date on it, but I think sometime in May to the June time frame, and then the school board would really have a prioritized list of items and some dollar figures of those items to know what their needs are going to be the next 10 years. Of course, they have their bonding capacity is maxed out right now and will come up, I think, 2017. Right. So that's a window that they have to hit to even come close to fulfilling their needs. So I think, you know, is some of the things that someone was mentioned before that they were concerned that Shawnee didn't vote for some of the initiatives in this last election. I think some of that had to do with the property tax aspect of the election and the fact that property taxes are so they're so crucial to funding the schools. And I think with our I-93 Ethernet Independent School District situation in Shawnee, I think that makes people a little nervous about dipping into that property tax pool, knowing that the schools have these great needs as well. So I think that weighed in a lot of the election as much as the issues themselves.
Shawnee and all public schools have an opportunity now that the governor just signed into law where they won't be liable for opening up their gyms and their athletic facilities, their baseball fields and things like that, so that they could make themselves Shawnee Board of Education and schools make themselves a lot of good points with the citizens by opening up those facilities and allow the Y and some other organizations.
They do that in Norman already.
But the bill that was just passed and the governor signed limits the liabilities for the school. That's been a problem where you open it up for public use as a liability. So now that's not a problem. And so it'd be good for the opening up some of the facilities, especially the gyms and the practice fields and stuff like that.
Again, where we can use some of the same facilities.
Right.
Different timing and different needs sometimes too. We've partnered where we could. I would throw out there too that we need to be creative on school funding. And I know there are some people here that don't want to hear me say that necessarily, but I think that we need to do that for the future too. Because we have some unique opportunities in our city for that. So I think it's a part, Mike. I do. The realm of our responsibility is the city. It is. It's encouraging to know that when you step out representing one entity into the arena of another one, that you have some support from people to both entities. We are and will continue to attempt to have conversations with all the school districts in this town. Yeah.
reserves in the Shawnee Mall. That's one thing that there, you know, if we're looking 20 years from now, we might, if we can talk together, we might be able to find some way to operate some other small library on the north side of Shawnee for people who don't want to come south. Which brings me to the reason a lot of people don't want to come south, which was something that a lot of our customers have a problem with at the library, which is people who are homeless who are in the library. And of course they have a right to use the library, it's a public building, as long as they're not breaking the rules. But I think any discussion about long-term needs of Shawnee should include some way of addressing what is a growing social problem for us, and how, what do we do to assist people who are homeless to get on a different route. And I know it's not easily solvable, but I'm hoping for a task force or something.
Did the chamber have a task force on that a year and a half ago?
We had a couple of meetings.
Okay.
Not an actual task force.
Okay.
We pulled all the groups together.
Trying to determine what the needs were, what the options were,
what they
offered, and where there was some overlapping service or what maybe. Okay. The beginning of a task force, then maybe. Okay.
What Oklahoma City has done is they've combined all the places where those individuals need to go to get assistance.
Yep.
Dan Strong, the Homeless Alliance, challenged our communities. We have all these different locations where they need to travel to get that assistance, and they're crossing retail areas, they're crossing downtown, they're right by the library, and that's
right.
I think they've seen some success from it in Oklahoma City, but that would take some major changes in our nonprofits. Kind of start to combine resources and find almost a complex relief.
Co-ed has a pretty good presence in the area. Putting together a data and I thought they were going to take that.
Who's that, Mike? I'm sorry.
Of all these dilapidated structures.
Yes.
I think that was several years back that Justin and his department was a big part of. I think, I don't know what the number is, but I've heard there's a big backlog of those homes that need to be demolished in Shawnee. What is that number? Is it a couple hundred? Is it?
Probably about 200. We have about 50 on the list right now.
I think that's a very positive step for our community. We got great PR in Oklahoma City and all of it, but it wasn't just about the PR. All these people that live in these neighborhoods, a lot of pride when you see that house torn down that's been the kind of the blight of your neighborhood and everyone else. As someone that lives in an older part of town, I really think that is vital to kind of keeping those property values high, and hopefully they'll even grow if you do some more of that. So that's a program I would hope we would find more funding for, to
So don't move that funding to the swimming pool for this year, is what you're saying? Yes. Okay. Just checking. Yeah. But you're right, we've had good results with that.
Are we seeing more increases in numbers of houses that are dilapidating? Because, I mean, it appears to me that there are more that people were living in, and there's more that nobody's living in now. Have you noticed any number increase?
The agency that has the best data on that is the U.S. Post Office, because they keep track of vacant mailboxes, essentially, and I haven't seen the latest.
I've seen lots of nice houses that have looked pretty bad within like 2 or 3 months with vandalism that people have moved out of, and it looks like it's increased to me.
There's a lot of foreclosures in this area. I'd have to say maybe there's a correlation there, too.
I think a lot of times probably the wiring just goes bad. I noticed there was one down at the end of Main, somebody cut a hole in the roof.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I've watched it. Each time I went by there, it's like gotten decreasingly worse.
All up meetings, and I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Right. Motion and a second. Can you get that, fellas? Can we all just read? How about that?
Power of choice.
Yeah. So this meeting is now adjourned.
I want to
Merry Christmas.